While the coronavirus crippled many industries in the last 2 years, it also pushed companies over the technology tipping point, transforming economies forever. A 2020 McKinsey Global Survey of Executives showed companies accelerated digitization by 3 to 4 years. Hello, everyone. I'm Mimi Yong, and welcome to ANC's special webinar on digital competition. Well, we've got an exciting lineup today, but first, let's take a minute to get to know the Philippine Competition Commission.
The Philippine Competition Commission was founded in 2016 through Republic Act 10667, also known as the Philippine Competition Act, which was passed the year before. It is the antitrust regulator of the Philippines, tasked to protect consumers, accelerate investment, and generate jobs through the enforcement of fair competition in the market. The law and the PCC believe that competition encourages businesses to thrive, which in turn promotes investment, innovation, productivity, and employment. It also believes increased competition forces businesses to provide better, more affordable products and services to the public. One of the primary ways the PCC pushes for a level playing field is by ferreting out existing monopolies and duopolies, recommending policies that would assure they do not abuse their market dominance and help bring down barriers that have kept out would-be challengers. The PCC also reviews mergers and acquisitions to ensure no new monopolies or duopolies are formed. It also imposes sanctions on entities that have abused their dominant market positions. The PCC assisted the National Telecommunications Commission and the Department of Information and Communications Technology when the government was searching for a third major telco player to challenge the duopoly of PLDT Smart and Globe and Telecoms. Its first abuse of dominance case was against listed developer 8990's Urban Deca Homes, which was planning to force its customers to avail of an in-house internet service provider, Fiber to Deca Homes, in 9 projects across the Philippines. The PCC continues to monitor key sectors such as telecommunications, agriculture, and construction to ensure competition is alive and well. But as an antitrust entity, it is tasked to police the most powerful and influential organizations in business and commerce. It's a tough task for an agency that has been around for less than a decade, in a country that is dominated by massive and entrenched conglomerates, some of which are over 100 years old.
And joining us today, the man at the helm of the PCC, economist and former socioeconomic planning secretary, Chairman Arsenio Balisacan, and he's been heading the agency since it was set up in 2016.
A pleasant day to everyone.
And joining us all the way from Singapore, Winnie Ching, the director for legal at the Competition and Consumer Commission of Singapore. Now, prior to joining CCCS, she worked at the UK Office of Fair Trading, now known as the Competition Markets Authority, and led litigations of a number of key banking and consumer protection cases. Hi, Winnie.
Thank you very much for the invitation to join today.
Next, we have globally award-winning brand architect and convener of Digital Pilipinas, Amor Maklang, is an innovator helping brands take the innovation leap and tech up. She's also co-founder of Geyser Maklang Communications.
Good day, everyone. Technology is indeed the greatest leveler in all of this. Salamat.
Okay, and our next panelist is a director at Incubator Startup Village. Carlo Calimon is an angelpreneur and mentor. He's also the founder of mobile and web app that helps merchants and customers connect via a digital mobile card. Now, what's keeping him busy these days? Project Match, a USAID-backed initiative that links MSMEs to financing and mentorship through a digital platform.
Good day, everyone. Happy to be here.
And last, but definitely not the least, our next panelist is a familiar face on TV. She used to co-host the now-defunct home TV channel O Shopping. Yes, Neri Sauyao, in 2019, founded a full-production, live-streaming shopping agency, Shoppertainment Live.
Hello, everyone. It's great to be here as well.
Citing research from consultancy firm Alpha Beta, the Department of Information and Communications Technology estimates the Philippines' digital economy can actually create up to 5 trillion pesos in value through digital transformation through the year 2030. For a background on the local digital economy, let's watch this.
Mint, now recognized as the Philippines' first unicorn or billion-dollar startup, Grab, the first Southeast Asian company to list on the US NASDAQ, Lazada, Shopee, and Zalora, which are synonymous with e-commerce and monthly sales. These are the names that now dominate the digital economy of the Philippines, in a space that was meant to be a great equalizer in business. Digitization was supposed to be the answer for companies that wanted to compete with the giants of retail, finance, and logistics, as a workaround against the old advantages of prime real estate holdings, widespread physical store networks, or entrenched infrastructure. A study by the Philippine Competition Commission released in 2020 reveals there are still some significant barriers to entry which have allowed certain players to achieve dominance in e-commerce. These include the economic advantages of the incumbents, costs and network effects, legal barriers, and the conduct of incumbent firms. Mint, for example, which operates GCash, the leading e-money issuer in the Philippines, enjoys the support of a well-known Philippine conglomerate, the Ayala Group, which includes telecoms giant Globe and another leader in digital finance, BPI. These are clear advantages that have helped this startup dominate the fintech market. Meanwhile, Grab, before its current super app iteration, was a ride-hailing app that was in heavy competition with another player, Uber. Grab ended that competition by buying Uber in a deal that was approved by the PCC, albeit with conditions requiring Grab to ensure its passengers and riders are given the best service and lowest prices. Lazada, Shopee, and Zalora, meanwhile, enjoy the backing of massive business groups as well. Lazada is controlled by Jack Ma's Alibaba, Shopee is backed by the Gokongwei Group, and Zalora is backed by the Ayala Group. The PCC notes the Philippine government wants to use e-commerce to generate more economic activity and create more opportunities for micro, small, and medium enterprises. It is focused on developing infrastructure, including telecommunications, investment through measures that would open up the Philippines to more foreign capital, innovation through the incentivizing of research and development, intellectual capital through the incentivizing of training and human resource development, information flows via the promotion of a trusted and secure internet environment, and integration via the interconnection of domestic and global markets. No doubt the COVID-19 pandemic has sped things along by forcing the economy to cut out physical interactions. But there remains key problems like equal access to connectivity and equal access to capital for startups. Has the internet acted as a great equalizer for Philippine business, or have entrenched business giants dominated this space as well?
Data from the Trade Department estimates e-commerce contributed 3.4% to the country's 2020 GDP, with 500,000 registered e-commerce businesses and growing. How does e-commerce fit into the country's post-pandemic future? How can consumers protect themselves from scams and dodge extra expenses? All right, so I think we're ready to get the ball rolling. I want to start with a question for everyone. Should we even aspire to level the playing field through the digital economy? I mean, is that even possible?
We need to make sure that there are no barriers to entry so that entrepreneurs, market players can come in and the current ones can expand. So there should be no prohibitions, no unnecessary impediments to entry and expansion.
Your question in terms of can we level the playing field, certainly in terms of the framework, can we level it in terms of ensuring that each business has an equal opportunity? I think that's very difficult. But by ensuring that you have that framework in where competition can take place, I think we can ensure that the best outcome occurs for businesses and consumers.
Amor, what are your thoughts on this? I mean, if you look at the likes of Grab, for example, on the surface, Grab looks like a startup catapulted to its $40 billion valuation by digital economy. But if you look deeper, it's actually backed still by a giant, by big capital, SoftBank's Masayoshi Son, a major shareholder for one, and it's run by people with experience. So what do you think about leveling the playing field through digital economy?
We have our own local player in the field, and what we want to be able and you know, at the end of the day, local players still have a closer touch with the market, everyone is listing in a global storefront. But what we would like to encourage in Digital Filipinas, especially as it pertains to the digitalization of MSMEs, is not just to get listed in a storefront, but rather to be their own storefront and to be able to gain control of the value chain behind e-commerce and not just be dependent on one big foreign player.
Let's hear from our entrepreneurs, our startup incubator, Carlo and Yas. What do you think about leveling the playing field by digital economy? And I wanted to share this because Great Deals of Steve C actually released a list of their top selling items during the 12/12 Christmas sale, the big sale event. For groceries, the top selling items were still Abbott and Nestle, for example. You've got P&G and Unilever. For diapers, it's Pampers. For home care, it's still P&G and Unilever. For pet care, it's Pedigree, Whiskas, and Royal Canin. For makeup, it's still Maybelline. So this pretty much tells us that there are so many small entrepreneurs, smaller players also listing with stores in Lazada, for example, but the top selling remains to be the big brands.
Digitalization really levels the playing field when it comes to different sellers. Of course, you all have the same tools, you all have the same marketplaces to be in and to showcase all of your products. You have the same traffic as well when it comes to putting your product in certain apps or platforms. But I think just like in any type of business, you need to have a lot of input so that you have a lot of output. And I think these multinationals put a lot of input in terms of creating a lot of efforts in their e-commerce stores. So if you have more input, definitely have more output. For SMEs, for example, they do have some tools, but the mastery of these tools is very different. Of course, when you have multinationals, they get to hire more people who are very educated in these type of digital tools, right? And they also have a lot of capital and products that they can put in. So definitely there would be a lot of output.
The e-commerce and digitalization provides a way to level the playing field. As you mentioned, these big brands are out there. And if you look at the next tier, you would see local brands coming up as well. Obviously, the bigger companies would have deeper pockets. They would have more resources in terms of innovation, but you would be surprised that, you know, startups also have an advantage in the sense that, you know, they're more nimble, they can move faster, they can act swifter. We have seen a lot of startups, which includes obviously Great Deals and so on, right, of Steve, that allows us to see, right, and how we can level the playing field. But to be honest, I've seen also some people working with Great Deals that have said, hey, I'm so happy. Why? Because I'm ranked, you know, close to or within the top 10 in that same list where multinationals are just normally found. So you could see some people or some companies, though obviously there's still a big divide, there's still an opportunity for them to play catch up. I think they just need more time and more possibly resources. And to also, as Yas mentioned, to get acclimated, right, in how to really work and maximize the digital space.
Mm-hmm. Chairman RC, the PCC, I know, has published a study on the behemoths of the Philippine e-commerce landscape. What did you find? Who are the giants in this space? And I'm very curious, sir, how hard is it to police, so to speak, the rich, the powerful, and the influential, the titans of these industries?
Yeah, last year, PCC published a study on the Philippine digital commerce market. That study found that e-commerce has a huge potential for growth and as a vehicle for our economic transformation. But we need to address the critical constraints to this growth, including barriers to entry and expansion and possible abuse of dominance by the incumbents, no? To realize the potentials of this emerging sector. In terms of website traffic, the big ones, as you also mentioned earlier, Mimiar, the Lazada remains the leading retail e-commerce platform, no, in the country. It's followed by Zalora, Shopee, and eBay. No? But there are many other forms of e-commerce out there. Because of the pandemic and the limitations in movement, we see that most people were forced to turn to these platforms for their shopping needs, from lifestyle products, apparels, and several home improvement items. The competition authority must be watchful of the incumbent, prematurely buying or absorbing a potentially creative, innovative competitor. And we have seen many of those in the evolution of this industry, not only in this in the Philippines, but in the global marketplace. And that's what the competition authority is monitoring closely, such that these opportunities for startups that Carlo mentioned will have the opportunity to prosper in a level playing field.
Chair Arce, I'm very curious, is it harder to do your job in the digital economy versus in the physical economy?
Well, there are challenges, just to be sure, because the current state of the digital economy is such that it far goes beyond the platforms that we talk about here, but also about the state of our of the backbones, the infrastructure that supports our digital economy, including the telecom infrastructure, for example, where we have big problems and the lack of investments, particularly in the last mile. No? We have to approach this in that context. While we pay particular attention to the e-commerce, we are also looking into the physical ones to ensure that this e-commerce economy will prosper.
All right, Amor, I wanted to get your thoughts. To many of us, fintech through digital wallets seem to be the entry point to participating in the digital economy, because finally you can do activities from end to end. You know, you shop, you work, you play, you entertain all online, and you pay online as well. Do you think our watershed moment has arrived? Do we have critical mass on fintech adoption already? I mean, they say, and we always talk about this, only 30% of Filipinos are backed with traditional financial institutions. Will fintech give us a better number for that?
Filipinos have always been prolific in terms of the uptake of nascent technologies. And it's not just with a wallet, right? Mimi, you and I have been talking about even in the uptake for crypto, we're actually one of the top three in the world. Now, the question as to whether, I also like what you raised about how fintech or the movement of money, which at the end of the day is what it is really the gateway drug, right, to teching up. Because once you're able to move the money, then it can fire up various verticals. That's why our perspective into fintech is not fintech as a vertical, but rather a horizontal. It's what powers insurance to transform it into insurtech, education into edutech. But I have to correct you. For me, the real language of love in a digital economy that will allow all of us to connect are APIs. It's not one, it's APIs. Because if everyone, every business is imbued with an API, it can freely connect to each other, to financial institutions, whilst at the same time controlling where your data goes to.
And Amor, for those who are non-techie, who are watching us right now, what is API? I know there's an analogy. It's like the waiter who gets your order and gives it to the kitchen. But could you help us visualize what an API is?
I think language is a better way to use this analogy. If you and I communicate because you speak English and I speak some marginal English. So what an API does basically is it's our data, it's our organization and our and someone else's organization connecting, exchanging data with permission, okay, with permission. So if that's the case, we are able to, for example, I'm a financial institution, I can provide immediate access to products, services, information. I mean, it's not just for payments. You can also use it for things like predicting public health, right? Or dispensing public health services.
Winnie, I know that the Singapore government has a smart nation strategy where the three key pillars are digital economy, a digital government, and the digital society. The ingredients to a successful e-commerce strategy. Of the three pillars, may I ask what is the biggest challenge in your ambition for Singapore to become Asia's e-commerce hub?
One of the, if you like, forefront runners that we're trying to institute is data portability, to encourage that flow of data within the economy. So individuals at the moment, and we're making moves that individuals can actually port their data across organizations. And again, it's structured, commonly used, machine-readable data that can be used by different organizations and therefore can be shared. Obviously, there are efficiencies involved in that, and obviously there are innovative opportunities with that too.
Chairman Arsi, I know that you recently inked an MOU with Singapore for cross-border cooperation. You've been working with Singapore back in 2018 for the Grab Uber case, right? But I mean, what sort of cooperation, collaboration should we expect from this sort of partnership between Philippines and Singapore?
Singapore and the Philippines, through our respective competition authorities, have been very helpful with one another, especially for us as a younger competition authority. We really learn a lot from the good practices of Singapore. And in the current case, in the case of the Grab Uber, for example, that was a very complicated case, especially for a young agency like us. But Singapore was much ahead, and they had a well-established system in their enforcement mechanisms. And we did reach out to them for assistance, and we did share what information about the proper way of handling this particular your case. Moving forward with the MOU, we intend to deepen the collaboration and cooperation between the two institute agencies, especially in relation to transborder transactions and. Of course, e-commerce is one of those, especially those digital platforms. Many of them are based in Singapore, for example. So we can learn a lot. We also have Singapore has also been playing an important role in our capacity building for our people, especially those involved with the digital economy.
Speaking of cross-border transactions, what about cross-border payments? Because I know the Central Bank in the Philippines also inked an agreement with the Monetary Authority of Singapore. Amor, could you tell us about that and how that could also help power the digital economy?
ASEAN is the largest fintech, and many of you know about the very unique work that the Monetary Authority of Singapore has done. And it's not just in the payment space. It's actually to help enliven many other work streams. And we're very proud that Digital Pilipinas is the partner of the MAS for these particular work streams. Now, you made mention, Mimi, and you were there when we signed during World Fintech Festival in Digital Pilipinas last November 12th. The expanded cooperation between Philippines and Singapore for fintech payments. And basically what this does is really work on three key areas: remittances, tourism, and MSME digitalization. So I think what we can really learn here is when we think of leveling up and creating a digital economy, you cannot help but think about others in the ecosystem. Right? So there's never been a truer time to say that with the rising of the water, all ships rise. No? And essentially, that's what Singapore is doing for all of us.
Carlo, yes. If you could give us, you know, anecdotes, what or who your standout clients or partners are and their experiences, those who have experiences or your own experiences clearly show how you're empowered by e-commerce, how you are empowered by the digital economy.
Through Project Match, we've worked with some local startups that help in digitizing, you know, MSMEs as well, not necessarily going through the usual e-commerce channels, but rather, like, for example, one of them, we were able to tap Prosperna. Prosperna is a startup that allowed for, you know, MSMEs to create their own digital storefronts. right? And you would be surprised that some MSMEs would be running after us because they were really looking, right, to create another channel for themselves directly, not just to connect with an e-commerce site, but rather because they want to run it themselves. But they just didn't have the technology or the know-how to do it. Mm-hmm. So startups like Prosperna allowed them, you know, some of the guys were even that approached us, they were hardware stores, or one of them was actually just, you know, starting out as a mushroom chips. And they wanted to create that storefront already because they were doing quite well already as a startup MSME also, whether it was Viber or through Viber or even, you know, the different social networks like Facebook and Instagram. And, you know, in addition to that, you also have startups who are augmenting and enhancing the chat and, you know, messenger functions by creating a storefront within these, what they call this, social media messengers like Chat Buddy and Chat Genie, who basically allowed MSMEs using their pages to automate and create that full sales experience, including customer relations management, inventory management, even delivery and payments, all through your messenger, right? So we have startups doing these things, and you know, it's always nice to see because there are MSMEs who are able to increase, right, their reach and sales and efficiency just by making use of a startup.
What about you, Yas? What's been your experience or your partner's experience?
So what we do is really more of the B2B arm, wherein we really create services and we provide live stream shopping campaigns in any type of brand. And it's amazing to see that there are actually both multinationals and also MSMEs who are also part of our clientele. Definitely, it would be more of the FMCGs and retail product manufacturers. But when digitalization really accelerated, especially for the past couple of years, and the behavior on e-commerce was really increasing, we've been seeing different categories as well. So I also have clients who are from different platforms doing live stream shopping and even have real estate. In fact, we've been doing real estate on different e-commerce platforms as well. So that's really amazing because we're really looking at these opportunities to sell more via digital in different categories that aren't usual when it comes to purchasing or adding to cart online. So those are some things that we've seen that's kind of different. We've also seen like an increase of sales. Like for the past couple of years, whenever you're doing your live stream, before it was like, let's say 1 to 2% in terms of conversion, but now we've been seeing like six digit figures in an hour of conversion just by live selling, right? So it's really that like a big leap in terms of conversion as well.
Winnie, you've heard from our Philippine startups, our Philippine entrepreneurs. Why don't you give us a sense of how Singapore's e-commerce landscape is? How vibrant is it there?
We see echoes of the same here. Mm-hmm. You know, we've got a lot of people who are able to access platforms where in the physical world, they wouldn't necessarily have the capital to do so, but are able to do so on a platform basis. And so there is this vibrancy coming through in terms of the markets. So if I take something like food delivery, for example, there is a huge number of different platforms that actually operate in the market, which we didn't see years ago. That said, you know, we obviously have to ensure that these this vibrancy continues and creating that space, if you like, that framework where competition can flourish is something that I think we aim to do as part of our role as a regulator.
Chair Arce, here's a quick question, a consumer question for you. Where does your mandate end and DTIs begin when it comes to competition on the digital economy? Is e-commerce, for example, consumer protection still within your scope as PCC?
That's a very good question, Minnie. Many people are probably been asking that. But let me say that these two are interrelated. They do affect one another, but strictly speaking, competition policy has to do with making markets work better to make prices affordable to for goods and services affordable to consumers and for the economy to continue growing out of productivity and innovations that competition and level playing field will promote. While consumer protection has to do with ensuring that consumers' choices are not constrained by violations from things like standards of goods and services, selling fake products, things like that.
Technology is not just opening up opportunities and doors for e-commerce or retail. It is also helping level the playing field for artists.
It's changing the game definitely when it comes to creation of value and creation of work or even the redefining of work. So NFTs for art, which I think it really kind of reached an impetus last June when we first spoke about it, because this is the first time the biggest digital exchange in the world actually opened up a segment for artists. No? So, like I said, it's changing the way we look at work, but the underpinning behind all of this, underneath all of this, is blockchain. It's that immutable technology that allows us to trade in trust, create value in a decentralized economy, meaning it's power back to the people. Now, and that's why technology could get very threatening when it comes to certain governments. What NFTs do is actually create a valuable use case for creating values outside of just remittances, because for the most part, it's been about remittances. But it's not the only space where it's affecting. You've heard of the play to earn, right? You've heard of the play to earn phenomenon of Axie Infinity that's really changing the way that people work. Imagine you're gaming. And at the same time, making crypto and fiat afterwards, no? And they're making real money. We've heard players who said, grabe, people think na nagda-drugs kami dahil all of a sudden we were able to pay our debts and now we have a big home, right? So it's another use case. And what we hope, Mimi, similar to what's happening in Singapore, is actually create more use cases. Mm-hmm. So payments is fintech and payments is the very obvious case study. But e-government, you want to cut corruption, you want to be able to create better transparency. There is no better tool than technology.
All right, we have so much to unpack. However, we have to go on a quick break. The world's most valuable commodity used to be oil. Today, it's data, yours and mine. And the all-new data economy is demanding a new approach to antitrust rules. More on that when we come back. The increasingly online nature of our lives means more opportunities for phishers, hackers, scammers, and extortionists. But it's not just about data that's stolen, but information we may be unwillingly and unknowingly giving away. Data is said to be the highest priced digital commodity today. How does the government regulate the collection and use of data? How can consumers protect their personal data? Do we even get a say? All right, I want to start with Chair RC and Director Winnie. This may sound like a trick question, but really, who owns my data? Do I own it or is somebody else owning it?
Certainly, the emergence of online platforms and media has made data one of the hottest commodities in the market. Businesses use data to understand consumer behavior and do predictive analytics. Businesses can say that collecting data from consumers is meant to help them have a better experience of e-commerce. But like you said, Mimi, there can be a number of ways to look at it. Some are finding ways to demand companies to pay for their data since businesses use it to generate profit. I think that's the big issue there. The common middle ground for both sides is limiting the purpose of data collection such that companies only use it to improve customer experience and develop marketing strategies.
Winnie, what about you? What's your take on this?
So I think there's a whole data ecosystem associated with it. You've got the individual, the business, who's using a particular tool, a platform that generates data. And then it depends on, if you like, the when they sign up to that platform, under what conditions. Who owns the data? It depends on which data, you know, we're looking at. And then under what terms have they, if you like, given that data or procured that data?
Yes, when you do your shoppertainment live, I'm curious, what sort of data are you able to collect? I imagine you do this real time. What data points do you see? They must be very interesting in real time. How granular, how specific can the information get when you do your lives?
So definitely we get to see the dashboard as well, which is provided by the platform and a tool. So we could see, of course, the viewership, the engagement, the type of products that they're really interested in, and also the store traffic that is coming in due to the campaign, right? So that's the data that we actually get from the platform itself. But we also get to have data, like what was mentioned, data that is with consent of the shopper, for example. So you want to get this promo, or do you want to participate in this certain survey? Then maybe we can ask for some data, and then in exchange, there could be something that you can win or you can have as a freebie. So that's something that you can also get depending on the objective of the campaign.
When you do give consent, though, when you join promos, for example, I'm curious, yes, is it ubiquitous? Is it, okay, you can get my data and then you can do whatever you want with it? Or is it a one-time thing? You can use my data once, that's it.
It should have the terms and conditions as well, so that the shopper or the client is also informed about what they are putting in.
It's all about the fine print, really, the tiny words under what we sign up with. Carlo, for the startups that you help incubate or match, how do you think they're seeing and handling data collection or disposal?
You know, they want to be compliant with the rules and regulations set forth by the government, obviously. And I think that, you know, with the startups, especially that we work with, everybody wants to be transparent. Everybody wants to, like what Yas mentioned, you know, everything is done with consent. You know, we're in Startup Village, we want to teach the startups the proper way to do it, right? Rather than just, you know, we all know how, you know, some entrepreneurs or even startups can be very shrewd in that sense. But for us, you know, we value ethics, we value the integrity of the startups because it's a reflection of them as an organization and as founders. So we want to make sure that, you know, from the very beginning that the startups are aware of this. But obviously, you know, in the beginning, especially with the startups that we also help when they're very early stage, they're still trying to get a feel of all of these data and they're still trying to gather, right, and assess this data, these data points. So, you know, it's still very open-ended, but at the end of the day, it's still being able to comply with the different regulations. Obviously, everything is done with consent.
Is the Philippine Competition Commission currently working on any case that has something to do with data privacy, data security?
Data privacy is not our jurisdiction. That's by another government agency. But we do look at the data issue from a competition lens. The things, for example, that are of concern to us are the concentration of that data and to the extent that that data is used in an anti-competitive way. For example, there's this thing called the first mover advantage and the network effects. And the combination of this scale economies of scope, you know, and the network effects, first mover advantage, this enable one or two players to dominate the market and prevent others from coming in, especially if there are cross ownerships along the value chain, and maybe that's one thing that you can discuss, because you know it that's where a lot, maybe a lot of the competition issues will be coming from. If the telco provider is also the internet service provider, is also the fintech provider, then you'll have potentially have a big problem with when it comes to entry of potential competitors or growing up of small players in the marketplace. So those are the ones that we are particularly focusing on to ensure that the e-commerce will grow as it should.
But Chairman, that's exactly what we have now. You've got telco giants building whole ecosystems. They're in telco, they're providing broadband internet, they're providing digital wallets. Yeah. How do you go about handling that challenge?
Yeah, you asked that question a little earlier, Mimi, when how does a competition authority handle the digital e-commerce versus the physical ones? That's precisely a challenge for many competition authorities around the world, particularly young and competition authorities in developing countries, where the technologies, even for the regulators, the tools that we have are mainly insufficient because these markets are evolving very rapidly. As you may know, governments sometimes are so slow in coming up with regulations that are relevant and pertinent to and timely for the market players. And this is a big challenge for us at the competition authority to make sure that the way we approach this issue is much with the time and it's quite consistent with the objective of growing the economy and we don't want to get in such a way that we achieve one thing but at the expense of the other and perhaps even bigger thing, which is in this case really growing the e-commerce, because that's the future. So there we are. For us at the competition authority, it's learning fast, and that's why we are connecting with more mature authorities like Singapore to get us ahead of the, or at least at pace with the technology and with the market players.
Director Winnie, how does the Singapore government regulate data collection? Do you have a test case for the challenging task of regulating the collection and the use of consumer data?
So that would be under another regulator, but it's under the Personal Data Protection Act. That would be, if you like, where you have the use and the collection in respect of personal data that falls under that category. But from a competition perspective, in terms of the collection and use, it is something that we are looking at ourselves. And that comes in relation to data portability. So we've been working with the Personal Data Protection Commission to try and facilitate that portability of individual data, and that data portability will come into effect in the coming months. And also in respect of data generally, it's ensuring that businesses don't use data in an anti-competitive way, which is what Chair Asim was talking about in respect of ensuring that framework allows scope for businesses to compete on a fair basis. And data being one important facet of competition, particularly in this digital age, needs to be watched fairly closely to ensure that there is that access, that there is that ability to share where it might be needed.
Amor, no data can be more sensitive than the ones our banks have on us. We're coming from a hacking incident in one of our biggest banks, in fact, our biggest bank in the Philippines. And then a month ago, a membership supermarket chain also announced client information leaked, even inactive clients, shoppers. Just how secure are our digital infrastructures at this point? And could blockchain technology be the answer?
You know, I wish that for every problem, blockchain could be the response. While it's a critical tool, right, to address many of the problems, there is a lot of mindset shift that needs to occur, especially from the guards, no? Current guards of the these verticals. Number one, maybe what I'd like to do, Mimi, with your permission, is maybe put out forth some ideas just as a thought starter for everyone here. Number one, your identity, data and your identity, that is a social justice mission. That's why we're so rabid about it. I mean, I just came from a discussion with, I had lunch with former Chair Mon Liboro and a few other members of our cybersecurity and RegTech consortium. We have to start understanding that there's value attached to data. For example, in 2018, I was in Tel Aviv for the DLD. It's an innovation, one of the biggest innovation conferences in the world. And there is a technology provider that actually values your data. And one of our, yes, and one of our companions, a chair for a major bank in the country, got his Facebook profile evaluated. And guess how much it is? $14,000. So there is a value to your data, which I am sorry, you cannot just sign away because you ticked off a consent form and agreed to receive an umbrella, I don't know, or a gift certificate for it, no? How many people actually do read the fine print, no? So you cannot just sign it away. So that consent regime that's being proliferated by big businesses is extremely problematic, something that we need to revisit. The onus must be on the companies and the organizations. So when you hear things like, ah, phishing yan, the real unspoken there is that the fault is with the consumers, which is something that we need to seriously revisit. Data portability was something that Director Winnie mentioned. So it's all about portability, not just of your personal data, but also of your credentials. So when you start talking about proof of work, for example, how do I know that I attended this webinar by the PCC and put it in my, and maybe put it in my resume and learn something for it? From it, you can't just issue some kind of certificate. It has to be portable and embedded on the blockchain. Now, last, and because this is all about the use of data and in relation to competition, unfortunately, many of the big establishments, the hegemons, right, in the industry, and Commissioner, I'm glad you're here. Chair, you're here. They're using data privacy as a deterrent to innovation because they're saying, no, we can't do that. We can't do this because, you know, it violates certain provisions. But really, ironically, and I mentioned this earlier about that language of love, remember APIs? The control really is with the people to choose what it is that I want to be able to give up.
Carlo, what do you want to add?
Just wanted to build up a little bit on what Amar just mentioned about, you know, the data privacy portion. And from a startup perspective, I think that, you know, while startups would want to be compliant with all of this, it is also quite expensive, especially for a starting organization, a starting startup who has very little data and they're still building up on that data to comply also. Why? Because, you know, all of these, what you call it, regulations, that the list is so long such that even if you're starting out, they're requiring you already to have a DPO, to have all of these, you know, certifications, but you still don't have that much.
Chair Arce, what do you think? It falls on you to play the tough balancing act to help, you know, these startups at the same time protecting consumers. What are your thoughts on this, sir? And if I may add a consumer question, should we be allowed to turn off the tap, so to speak? Are we allowed, is it possible that we ask the digital platforms to delete our personal data after a certain period? I know that Google, for example, has this feature that you can actually request it to expunge data on you.
Yeah, I think that our laws and regulations regarding data are still evolving. And this is perhaps one of the things that we should ask our lawmakers to prioritize on, and especially on that tapping issue. But I think that Amor has raised an important issue. To what extent these data are really private goods, you know, and not public goods there that are accumulated by or used by anyone who are outside of the original, say, consent. For example, should third-party businesses be permitted to allowed to use even your data that are accumulated by another business whom you have or the consumer has consented with. I think that's a big issue. I would like my data to maybe in the future, you know, we can create a market for data so that you know, if you're really a very valuable you know, person with so valuable identity credentials, you should be able to sell that, you know, to, in the market, you know, and that way, you know, the problems might be internalized. Okay, but that's something that you know, for us to be further thinking about. The what is more, I think, serious concern is the one pointed out by Carlo regarding compliance cost of startup and SMEs. Indeed, the practice in many governments by our regulatory agencies is a sort of, you know, one size fits all, one regulation applying to everyone, you know, whether you're a big hegemon or a small business operator. No? Competition authorities around the world have been grappling with this issue. There are, for example, some jurisdictions that exempt small and medium enterprises from, you know, the usual rigidities of mergers and acquisitions. At the PCC, we have also been reframing and continuing to develop our rules and say mergers and acquisitions so that those areas where there are clearly no potential or a competition concern should be able to proceed without any you know, long process and many data submitted to the competition authority, things like that. And I think that this is a challenge that regulators, not only the PCC, but many other regulatory agencies in government have to respond to, so that businesses and, again, level playing field can truly be realized.
All right. Thank you for that, Chair Arce. Coming up, we look at policy support for the digital economy. We will be right back. The digital space is evolving at breakneck speed, making it very hard for policy to keep up. There are still so many gray areas over policing powers, even taxation, which is why enabling and supportive government policies are key, or else the real benefits of the new frontier technology will remain locked away. So I want to start this round with Carlos and Yas. Are the government policies that we have enabling and supportive, or do you find them restrictive? Is the government or regulators giving you enough room to grow, to experiment, to iterate as you bootstrap your startups?
Definitely, we do get support from the government as well as a startup. So we do get enough education as well from DTI. So DTI is very helpful when it comes to helping a lot of MSMEs to transition into digital, especially during this time wherein, you know, it's quite hard to sell more products when you have a lot of physical stores and you have to transfer online. So definitely, that's a great initiative by the government agencies, DTI for MSMEs. In terms of, let's say, shipment and logistics, I think, some of my friends who are in that aspect of e-commerce, they would say that there are some barriers to entry that are quite difficult when it comes to importation. So I think that can be a barrier in a way when it comes to the whole process of purchasing online. I think also that the fact that we are able to have another service provider for internet also makes it better for us who are also in that that space of you know, being a tech-driven company. Having more internet providers also lowers the cost of internet and, of course, wider access for a lot of Filipinos. So that's also very good for us who are in that space as well.
Mm-hmm. The chairman is actually here. He's worked on, you know, the new entrance. That's why we have new entrants, because of the chairman. Is there anything that you'd like, is there a wish list, yes, that you have for the chairman to work on maybe next year?
Definitely speed in terms of internet, because our business really relies on the speed of the internet. And of course, the faster the internet is, the more people can actually view the content that we have, can actually purchase online, and access to different households for internet to increase, right? So I think that's one way to address that.
Okay, Carlo?
The government as a whole, you know, we've had a good start, especially from a startup perspective, especially with the Philippine Startup Act and the Philippine Innovation Act. And these have, you know, really paved the way for us to move the ecosystem forward. But as we understand, to develop an ecosystem, you know, it takes some time. And there's still a lot of parts that can be improved. Like, for example, education is still a key facet that needs to be improved, especially for the talent that we need to further grow our business. Also, from a competition perspective, I think that also coming up with incentives and improvements to incentives for investments in particular, because as you mentioned, if you look at the examples of the big companies that are proliferating the industry, a lot of them are backed by these big financial organizations from outside of the Philippines. Or if they are within the Philippines, they would be backed by a big conglomerate, local conglomerate. Yeah. So if you're looking at a startup that is seeking for funding, and how, if you want them to begin competing equally with the big guys, how will they do so if they don't have enough access to the resources, as I mentioned, right? And that's something that we want to do with Project Match, to level the playing field. But obviously, you know, having banks, venture capitalists, and angel investors, well, it's not enough, right? And I think, you know, Amor also mentioned it earlier, you know, that there is something that, you know, startups can tap. But I think that, you know, incentivizing and improving the behavior for investment and access to these investments locally for a local startup, especially because, you know, we've heard from everywhere that, you know, there is money in the Philippines. There are people who can invest in a startup, right? But unfortunately, you know, they're still very traditional. It's not part of their behavior at this point. So how do we encourage that? Unless, you know, obviously we get 10 more unicorns and so on. We've had our first one, but, you know, it doesn't convert overnight.
Another big buzzword for innovation for tech is the word sandbox. How does the Philippine sandbox look like today?
First and foremost, what is a sandbox, right? So it's exactly what we played with when we were kids. It's a supervised, limited play area under the aegis of, say, our teachers at that time, and in this case, it's our regulators, so that we can do a test and learn approach to certain problems. No? So we've had very successful case studies of sandboxing certain innovations in the payment space where implementing regulations have not yet been undertaken, right? So, and once again, we're going to mention the cooperation between, say, the Banco Central ng Pilipinas and the Monetary Authority of Singapore, and triggered by leads in the private sector. So taking that particular model, so we've created sandboxes that have allowed us to cut dramatically, say, for example, remittance costs to almost negligible levels. So using technology. Now, park that thought. There are so many much more innovations. So you mentioned a particular ride-hailing app. When we Filipinos tried to innovate on the ride-hailing arena, because there were no implementing rules and regulations, or if because the rules are actually like 50, 60 years old. So when they talked about two-wheel drives, they actually meant horse and buggy. I kid you not. We call it the Kalesa rule. So what do we do? If you're an innovator and you want to be able to implement innovation, what do you do? So this is why we're advocating for a sandbox approach in various national line agencies, so that if any innovator coming, say, for example, from Startup Village or elsewhere, would like to propose a particular innovation, then they can put it out under the aegis of the government, and maybe Commissioner, Chairman could actually be here. Chairman RC could actually take the cudgels here, because we need a group that cuts across various national line agencies. So yeah, it's the only way to make innovation happen. Then coupled with what we're doing with the MAS, which are hackathons. Now we call them hackoliseums, and this is where we take our problems and then present it to the rest of the world and get technologists out there to help us solve them. So very exciting times, Mimi.
Very exciting indeed. And you've got a champion here at Chair RC listening. I'm sure he's taking down notes. He's going to be an ally. He is an ally for innovators and for startups and entrepreneurs. I want to go back to Carlo and Yas. While a level playing field is the ideal scenario, it appears, at least to me, that there will always be a glass ceiling. And that's, you mentioned it, Carlo, access to capital. You can grow, yes, only up to a certain point. You can scale, yes. You can reach more, yes. But to be able to break that ceiling, you need money, because money will talk. Money will get it done for that next leap. The Philippine Stock Exchange has launched a hand-holding program for MSMEs. The PSE is waiving some of the rigid requirements just so they can embrace the startups, the entrepreneurs, to come on, tap the markets list, we'll give you your capital and grow. I guess my question now, Yas and Carlo, is they're ready. Are you ready? Are the startups, are the entrepreneurs ready to take the next step?
Some startups are ready, right? Especially the more mature ones. However, I think that for the younger startups, I think there is still a lot of education that still has to happen. Why? Because, you know, everything that they've read about, everything that, you know, they've been exposed to has either been funding coming from, you know, the three Fs, family, friends, or fools, as we say it, in the beginning stage, or really bootstrapping, you know, coming from revenue. But more importantly, most of their focus has been getting investors or investment from VCs and angels, for that matter. I think that, you know, there are two funding sources that, you know, are underutilized for startups. Basically the banks, right? And also the capital markets in this case, right? And I think, you know, we need to educate them more. But my thinking, I agree with you that, you know, there's always going to be that gap, right? But that's part of competition. Right, having that small gap, but at the very least is that, you know, that gap is bridged by giving opportunities for the next guys to also achieve that level. It's not necessarily about, you know, everybody on the same playing field, but giving them a chance to get to that playing field. But if the chance is blocked off, then that's where, you know, there is an absence of competition, a real competition in that sense, because you want companies like, you know, Shoppertainment, Great Deals, and so on, to also get to that point where they can compete with the big guys. But getting there is what, you know, we need to support. But the capital markets, I think, it's a good opportunity, but that's something that really is not yet within the preview of a lot of startups. But also take note, in order for a startup especially, I know some startup companies also have approached me that are focused on also helping startups get into the secondary board of the PSE and so on as an alternative channel. They're also trying to educate the startups on this aspect, but there is still that level, right, by which they can qualify.
Okay.
But if you look at the startups, they can't even reach that point because they run out of fuel earlier on. And that's what I meant about, you know, also incentivizing the earlier ones, because they're still at that point when, okay, my traction is still getting there, or I'm still figuring out my business model, but I'm running out of fuel to make me reach that point where I have become, you know, attractive for at least the secondary board, or in this case, you know, as you mentioned, that board for the MSMEs this coming year.
Apart from the investors being ready, I think the entrepreneurs should also take responsibility, that they should actually create money for the investors as well. I think that's one thing that a lot of startups are, you know, sort of, they would just get a lot of investments, but at the end of the day, the business model isn't working. So that might be quite difficult for the startup to work. And of course, if that doesn't work, then more investors will get turned off. Right. So I think it's really more of going back to the board and really understanding if what you're doing is something that would be sustainable and would create money and make it more sustainable for the economy. Right. I think it's more of the education as well. Apart from just, you know, having the infrastructure and having the resources, but are you really ready in terms of making it sustainable as a small business? What's your game plan? I think, again, the responsibility would be bigger when you do get the investors. So you have to take that in mind as well.
I'm going to segue to Chair Arcee now, because the telco industry is very excited. The Senate has just passed amendments to the Public Services Act, essentially opening up certain industries like telcos to more foreign ownership beyond the 60-40 limit. Do you think this is a right step, or a step in the right direction, to open up more instead of, you know, being nationalist with our policies to protect our local players?
It is certainly a huge step in the right direction, Mimi. We have been advocating this for decades now, because we do see that it is the lack of foreign investment that has been hindering the growth of many of our public services, you know, including the telco. So it's we have to watch, though, carefully how the implementing rules and regulations will be crafted, because that can be another critical step. No, you may have a very good good law, but the implementing rules and regulations are not going to be as supportive as the intent of the law. Then you'll have a problem. So we'll have to watch carefully the development there.
Chairman, I think we're ready to close the forum. I understand that you're going to be sharing some of your recommendations on how we can make the Philippines digital economy competitive, safe, and affordable. Chairman, the floor is yours.
There's no doubt about the contribution of digital platforms, no, in making the exchange of goods and services possible, especially amid the pandemic. The rise of e-commerce has also emphasized the importance of reliable IT and telco infrastructure to the economy. So sufficient and strong government support will surely help the industry realize its full potential. I think that also includes the call of Carlo earlier about support for startups. The implementation of well-crafted and informed policies is the way to go. This involves updating our plans in developing and augmenting our IT infrastructure to facilitate more efficient commercial exchanges. The ambition calls for a whole of government approach, including the participation of the PCC. As I emphasized earlier, the problems of high cost of internet, for example, runs across the whole chain, from the inflow of foreign investment to physically building that infrastructure, all the way to exclusivity dealings that are prevalent in many sectors of the economy. You know, so this would have to be addressed. The PCC has always been vigilant of the digital market from pre-pandemic years. And during the height of the lockdowns last year, as you enter 2022 and prepare for post-pandemic recovery, e-commerce remains a priority sector for PCC. This means it's a priority area for enforcement and advocacy operations to ensure that any antitrust issue in the sector is dealt with. From investigating possible anti-competitive agreements and abuses of dominant position to advocating for competitive policies, PCC is committed to helping the e-commerce grow into a significant contributor to a healthy and fair economy.
All right. Thank you, Chair RC. We are going to have to leave it at that. Hopefully, we've shared enough information to tickle your imagination and make you question, think, and innovate as we all go through this powerful digital transformation. The opportunities are clearly there. Will entrepreneurs and startups rise to the occasion? Thank you, everyone, for sharing your insights with us. And to our audience, you have just seen ANC's webinar on digital competition. I'm Mimi Young for ANC. Thank you for watching.